Nung unang kinumprunta ni Senate President Zubiri si Speaker Romualdez tungkol dito sa ginagawa nila, ang sabi nga ni Senate President Zubiri, you mentioned people's initiative, but you'd mentioned economic provisions, not this, not diluting the Senate. Ang naging sagot at tugon lamang ni Speaker Romualdez sa pag-uusap daw na yon, wala ako dun eh, ay nakalayag na yung barko, mahirap nang pabalikin sa puerto yan. Nakalabas na yung toothpaste sa tube, mahirap nang ibalik yun dun. Wala siyang sinabi sa harap ni Senate President Zubiri na, uy, ba't ako sinisisi mo? Wala yan, ha? Hindi kami yan. Hindi. I think it's safe to assume, Karen. Even the instructions and the timelines and the dates that came out, that Senator Aimee brought out, it all came from members of Congress. Dahil hindi naman kami magkakagalit personally, Karen, kaugnay sa bagay nito, magkaiba lang ng pananaw marahil. Now, at the bulwark of any democracy or government is transparency and accountability. Why aren't they being transparent and accountable for this? Habang dinedenay nila, habang multo raw yung nakikita namin, ang blow-by-blow naman na nagbibigay ng update tungkol sa People's Initiative ay puro mambabatas. Bakit ganun? Maliwanag ang naging desisyon ng Korte Suprema marahil nagising sila ng huli doon. Ang sabi ng Korte Suprema sa Lambino, kapag ka ang isang People's Initiative ay hinaluan ng sinumang opisyal ng gobyerno o grupo sa gobyerno, hindi na ito People's Initiative talaga. Pambababoy na ito ng prosesong yan sa ating saligang batas at politicians' initiative na ito. Yun ang salitang ginamit ng Korte Suprema sa Lambino case. Marahil huli nilang nakita yon, kung kaya't medyo umaatras at nagde-deny na, bagaman obvious na pinagmalaki na nila ito last year. Sila ay nagsulong at nagsimula nito at the beginning of the year at sila ay nagbibigay ng update kaugnay nito hanggang sa ngayon.
Okay, so Senator Cheese, you are not technically against changing the charter, or are you?
I don't know. What are the proposals, Karen? Yung proposed na charter change nila na gawing joint voting is a revision. It's not an amendment. I saw your interview with Justice Scarpio and I completely agree. In fact, if you look at Webster's dictionary, the definition, the distinction between revision and amendment is quite simple. Kung meron kang tinatanggal, revision yon. Kung meron kang idadagdag, amendment yon. Ito, may tinatanggal sila. Dinefine din ng Lambino yung revision. Kapag ka binabago mo ang system of government o system of checks and balance, revision yon, hindi yon amendment. Bagaman simple lamang yung nakalagay sa People's Initiative. Bakit, Karen? Binabago mo yung bicameral system ng checks and balance natin kung saan kung kailangan nga magkahiwalay bumoboto ang Kamara at Senado pag aaprubahan ka ng local bill, pagpapalit ng pangalan ng kalye, ng eskwelahan sa isang barangay, kailangan magkahiwalay na bumoboto. Tapos pagpapalit ng saligang batas, sabay ng boboto, binabago na nila yung sistema. It's clearly a revision and not a mere amendment. Nasa ilalim ng COMELEC rules mismo, hindi saklaw yon dahil in-adopt ng COMELEC rules noong 2020 yung Lambino case at yung Lambino decision.
Okay, so Senator, what do you think then is really going on? Because sources have told me that at one point, the President intervened and actually said the Senate will take the lead when it comes to the economic provisions. So I remember that the Senate President even assigned Senator Sonny Angara to get that. And then I think it moved to Senator Robin Padilla. And then suddenly all the senators, all of you signed unanimously a resolution that you were all against the ongoing People's Initiative. So ano po ba ito? Iba po ba ang hinaharap na mukha sa inyo? Is it two-faced? How would you describe it?
Well, Karen, I was not there in those meetings, but it was relayed to me by Senate President Zubiri. Kaya siya nag-commit na mag-file para masimula ng pag-uusap kaugnay sa economic provisions. Dahil nag-commit din ang speaker, kaya nagulat kami na biglang hindi na inaamin, natitigilan din ito. Yun ang quid pro quo dapat noon. Nasabi na rin ni Senator Pimentel to. Nung hindi tumitigil yun, tumutuloy-tuloy at tila nagde-deny na hindi daw sila yun, parang ang ginagoyo, hindi lang kami, pati ang Pangulo. Dahil nandun yung Pangulo na nag-usap-usap sila. Why don't you take the lead? Ang klarong kapalit noon ay titigil nila to. Subalit hindi naman tumigil at ngayon nga ay dine-deny pa na hindi naman daw sila yun. So para sa akin, Claren, hindi lang siguro double-faced, boodle na siguro ang tawag doon sa simpleng salita o pananalita ng ating mga kababayan. dahil itong people's initiative na to, ang layunin nito talaga, pasimplihin ang pagpapalit ng saligang batas kung saan ang gusto nila sa Kamara ay siyang masusunod na. That is not a democracy, Karen. In a democracy, you convince each other to take your side. In a democracy, if you cannot convince each other, then in an election, you face each other and whoever the majority wants and votes for, then that's what we should respect, whether we agree with it or not. Ito ang ginagawa nilang strategiya dahil ang Senado hindi makumbinse, burahin na lang sa equation pagdating sa pagpapalit ng saligang batas. And one more question, Karen. The House pulled the fast one when they removed money from the operations of COMELEC to prepare for 2025 elections and moved most of it, about 12-14 billion, to the Fund of COMELEC for Plebiscite Initiative and Referendum. As if to say or admit na mas importante ito dahil pag ito natuloy natin, hindi na kailangan magprepara ng COMELEC para sa 2025 elections. And it's slowly coming out too. Some congressmen are speaking. The last one I saw was Congressman Villafuerte who said, well, we have to look at term limits because unfair naman, 6 na taon yung mga senador. Kami, 3 taon lang. Pagsamahin mo yung 3 term namin, 9 taon lang yun. Sila, 12. Nagsalita rin si Oñate, tinuturo nilang Ginong Oñate, tinuturo nilang convener daw nitong bagong pirma initiative na namang ito. Ang salita niya, well, ang layunin talaga namin gawing unicameral to. Hindi naman papayag ang Senado maging unicameral to, kaya kailangan gawin ito. Pangatlo, in-interview mismo si Pangulong Marcos, kaugnay dito, kung napanood mo yun, Karen, binanggit niya hindi lamang economic provisions, ha, pati term limits dahil yun daw ang nagiging sanhi ng political dynasty sa ating bansa. Dahil kapag nag-graduate yung lalaki, papatakbuhin yung asawa, at pag nakatikim na ng poder, kailangan ng hanapan ng iba pang pwesto, kaya nagkakaroon daw ng dinastiya sa ating bansa. Now, these are indicators that it's not limited to economic, that it's not limited to simply diluting the Senate, removing the Senate's position insofar as our bicameral system, in amending the Constitution or even in passing laws. Obviously, unti-unti nang lumalabas yung talagang pakay o nasa sa loobin nila kung kaya't ginagawa ito.
Mm-mm. So the real intention, what you're seeing and others I've also interviewed, is it's not really economic. That's like the icing, just the icing on the cake. But really, it's changing the political system.
Let me address the economic, Karen. Okay. You've covered foreign chambers of commerce. In none of the surveys I've seen for the past 10 years, did they say that opening up the economy is a condition sine qua non, a condition precedent before they would do business in the Philippines? The number one complaint for the past 10 years or even longer has always been power. Number two is absence of a level and stable playing field where the rules of the game will not be changed. Number three is red tape. Number four is corruption. Number five is that whenever you have an administration coming in, all of a sudden you have to start from square one. That has always been their complaints. None of them actually mention opening up the economy. Now, if you compare our country, for example, with China, a communist country where there is no private ownership and everything is owned by the state, yun, ni walang 60-40, 100%. You cannot own land, period. Then why is business flourishing in China? Why is it flourished in China for the longest time? I don't get and understand that. So it's nice to debate on it. It's nice to talk about it. It's nice to hear their side and what their basis is. Asan ba yung basis nyo na sinasabi nyo yan yung kailangan para lumago yung ekonomiya? I'll bring it a step further. Yung sinasabi ng House na ginawa ni Senate President Zubiri na amendments, buksan ng advertising. Yayaman ba tayo pag binuksan ng advertising sa mga foreigners? Buksan ng media. Yayaman ba tayo doon? Biglang papasok yung mga negosyo at trabaho dito? Buksan daw yung higher education or wag daw yung basic education. So ganun kalalaki mga bagay yun? Ganun talaga? I don't see it, Karen. I don't see it as being an urgent priority, really. And that's what the people said too in the latest survey where 1% only said that it's needed. 99% said it's not. So maliwanag naman na ginagamit lamang na bihikulo yon, justification yon. Pero unti-unti naman ang lumalabas yung mga iba pang problema ang nais daw nilang baguhin. Ang problema talaga, Karen, dito ay lahat yon ay magiging posible na at bukas at napakadali na kung mapapasa at kung matutuloy itong People's Initiative.
And I'd like to add, just because we're talking about it, I interviewed Christian Mounsou just to strike a balance. I mean, holistically into the conversation, is he said manufacturing as it is can be 100% foreign owned. Power as it is can be 100% foreign owned. And Senator, what about mining? You can be foreign owned if you're partnered with the government. Ano yung situation sa mining?
There has been a way around it, which all mining companies have been doing in the Philippines, Karen. They have a financial agreement with the Filipino that says, since the foreigner provided the capital, he will control the shares of stock until he recovers his capital. That is the practice. Wala namang Pilipino, Karen, na ganung kayaman na nagsimula ng mining dito nang walang tulong mula sa foreign capital. Higit pa dun sa kanyang shareholding dun sa mining company. And that has been the practice for quite some time. And people are looking the other way because it's a legal instrument, a legal document that fits into our existing laws. Also, yeah. Remember, Karen, Congress already passed a law, the public amendments to the public service law, that basically opened up our economy to the tune of what needs to be opened up. It's questioned before the Supreme Court. It's pending there right now. But that has already been done by Congress as well. So again, if the score was 50-50, 60-40, 55-45, but the score in the latest survey is, only 1% of our people think that this chacha is necessary. People want government to address basically the high prices, the lack of opportunities and jobs, and certain security concerns.
And let me add also, just for our viewers, telecom and railway can now be foreign owned, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes,
so that was a big shift in the Public Service Act because it
was under... Yun, mas malaki pa yun, Karen. Uh-oh. Ang pinag-uusapan dun sa amendments na gusto nilang isulong daw ay eskwelahan, advertising, ganon. Parang hindi naman yata.
Mm-mm. Okay. So, do you agree then with Senator Risa Ontiveros that charter change may actually lead to more instability than attracting more foreign investors?
Well, we're seeing that now, Karen. In fact, 2 days ago, our NEDA chief, Secretary Balisacan, said as much, that all of this noise and talk about charter change, the discord, the disunity, are scaring off businessmen. Number two, you saw that yesterday as well. A lot of people were surprised with the remarks of former President Duterte. And you see this unity not only within the supposed uniteam, but also within and amongst our people insofar as this is concerned. No president wants this, Karen. No president would want instability, divisiveness, and absence of unity when you're trying to govern and go through an economic crisis or trying to recover or rebound from an economic crisis brought about by the pandemic years ago.
Okay, all right. Now let's talk about political changes. Charter change or the attempt of it isn't new, right, Senator?
Yes.
Even from the time you were an oppositor regarding this already during the time of former President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo. But FDR tried it. Former President Arroyo tried it. Former President Duterte, in his own way, tried it. Put up a commission to study federalism. I believe only former President Estrada wasn't able to venture this far because of the impeachment trial. But what makes the others different from today?
They learn from the mistakes of the past, Karen. That's why now more than ever, this so-called People's Initiative, what Senator Joel calls Peking Initiative, what the Lambino case Politicians Initiative, is closer than ever before to achieving this. Because before, Karen, there was no budget for a plebiscite for this purpose. Pero gaya na nasabi ko, nalusutan ng Kamara ang Senado kaugnay sa bagay na yan. So ngayon may budget para dyan. Noon kasi nagsisimula pa lang sila at kung tumututulong mayuriya ng mga senador, imposible nang mabudgetan yung plebisito. Pero ngayon may budget, so mas malapit-lapit sa katotohanan kumpara dati. Pero yung reaction ng tao, Karen, noon man o ngayon, ay pareho at ang basehan ay pareho. It doesn't matter what they're saying for public consumption that they will amend, like now, economic provisions. May duda ang tao, malakas ang duda ng tao na politika ang babaguhin at hindi naman talaga yung sa ekonomiya. Rason kung bakit maraming tumututol dito. Siguro reflection din yan na lahat ng mga nagtangka noon man o ngayon, kulang ang tiwala ng tao na hindi papakialaman yon para sa mga pansariling interes lamang at hindi sa kapakanan talaga ng bayan.
Okay, all right. I'm curious with this. What do you think of some? Of course, term limits were brought up, and it for many people it feels self-serving. But you do have suggestions of the change in voting for the president and the vice president. May mga nagsabi dapat gawin tandem voting para hindi na nag-aaway daw yung pangulo at VP. When will there ever be a time, or do you think there would be the right time to change certain political provisions?
Ang tawag doon, Karen, block voting. Nangyari na yan noong panahon ni dating Pangulong Marcos. Semi-block voting tayo noong 1986 snap elections. Bakit semi? Pag binoto mo ang presidente at blanco ang vice, automatic boto na yan para kay Tolentino. Automatic boto na yan para kay Doy Laurel ng mga panahon yon. Pero pag binoto mo ang vice presidente at blanco ang pangulo, hindi automatic na boto kay Pangulong Marcos at Pangulong Aquino yon. May semi-block voting na tayo noon dahil nilagay yon sa batas ng mga panahon yon. Karen, again, it's not a question of timing. It's a question of credibility. It's a question of trust or the absence or lack of trust. Lahat yan magagawa kung buo ang tiwala ng mas nakararaming Pilipino sa nagpapatupad ng pagbabago sa saligang batas, na hindi ito magiging makasarili, na ito'y para sa kapakanan lamang talaga ng bayan, na hindi ito minamadali, hindi ka nagtatagot, nagde-deny ka, inaamin mong ito talaga ang gusto ko, at tatayuan mo, papaliwanag mo sa tao, at hindi yung kung ano-ano ang rason na binibigay sa pagbabapirma nang hindi naman talaga pinapaliwanag yung issue. Ang isang bagay ang tumama sa akin sa sinabi ni Pangulong Duterte kagabi na parang minamaliit, tinatratong ignorante yung tao, na isang mahalagang bagay tulad ito ang pinag-uusapan tapos nagpapapirma lang kung saan-saan at hindi man lang pinag-uusapan, wala man lang malayang debate, wala man lang malayang diskusyon bago magpapirma kung sakasakali, o palawigin man lamang konting panahon para tulugan man lang niya, balikan sa susunod na linggo. Hindi yung pagpunta pa lang sa barangay ay pirmahan agad, iba't ibang rason ang binibigay sa iba't ibang parte ng bansa. Hindi ganyan dapat tinatrato ang isang seryosong bagay tulad ng pagbabago ng saligang batas.
All right. Now, you mentioned former President Duterte, part of his speech yesterday. So over the weekend, we saw, I would have to say, two rallies, right? The two gatherings of a huge number of people, one in Manila and the other one in Davao. Let's talk about the Davao first. Number one, are you seeing a breakdown in the so-called Uniteam, Senator?
Yes, Karen, to the tune of about 98-99%. Bakit may naiwang 1-2%? Dahil nagpunta muna si Vice President Sara sa Luneta bago siya nagpunta ng Davao. So may konting tira pa, may naiiwan pa. Pero dahil sa presensya niya sinabi, maanghang na salita. Hindi man nagsalita si Vice President Sara, although baka hindi ko na lang inabutan. Maanghang na salita ang binitiwan ni Pangulong Duterte, ni Mayor Baste, ni Congressman Pulong sa kanyang presensya na hindi naman niya pinagtanggol ang Pangulo at hindi naman niya pinigilang magawa o sabihin. Sa mga 98-99%, Karen, and it all began as you have seen nung nagpropose si Pangulong Marcos ng confidential funds para sa OVP at DepEd. Di ba, budget niya yun eh, siya yung nagsubmit ng budget na yun. Kakampi naman niya ang speaker, majority coalition ay hawak niya, pinsan pa niya ang speaker. Bakit tinanggal yon nang hindi man lang din siya pumapalag o pumoposisyon unless pinayagan niya? Dalawang bagay yun. Pinayagan niyang tanggalin, sumang-ayon siyang tanggalin, o di na lang niya pinakialaman at hinayaan na lamang ang Kamara at ang Senado ang gawin yun. Pangalawa, Karen, nung pumosisyon si Vice President Duterte laban sa peace talks, laban sa amnesty, wala rin naging kasagutan o katugunan mula sa Pangulo doon. Ngayon sa bagay na ito, ang panawagan ni Pangulong Duterte, gayon din siguro ako, sasang-ayon ako doon, is for him to rein in the speaker, for him to rein in not only his political ally, not only his fellow member in the coalition, but also his first cousin. I hope he will not simply shrug his shoulders and look the other way as if nothing is happening. Mm-hmm. Right now, it's only the speaker being pointed to at this point in time as responsible for it. But at some point, tatamaan, babalingan, tulad ng ginawa ni Pangulong Duterte sa rally, at aabutan na rin siya. Maliban na lamang kung poposisyon nga siya. His silence will always be interpreted as acquiescence. I hope he will not remain silent on this issue and nothing simply happen at the risk of creating instability in our country, even perhaps of his own administration. I hope that will not happen because that will really be bad for our economy. That will really be bad for our people. And the poor will only get poorer if that situation should explode.
All right. Now, you said you want the president to rein in on the speaker, who is also his first cousin. That's the same sort of statement that Senator Coco Pimentel said when I asked him, what's your message to the president? My message to him is to speak to his cousin and say, stop all this foolishness. Yun yung mensahe niya. But when you rein in on someone, it appears that person is in control. Are you saying at this moment in time that the speaker has more power or is running things already beyond possibly the president's? Go ahead.
Clearly, Karen, legally and constitutionally, the president is by far more powerful. Mm. Unless he lets people with less power, less stature and position do the things that they want to do, and by his silence or acquiescence is able to do so. That's the only time people of lower positions become or seem to become more powerful than the president himself, who should be the most powerful official in our country. Doon lang naman nagkakaroon ng poder yung mas mabababa ang pwesto. Kapag ka pinapabuelo ng mas makapangyarihan, hindi nagsasalita yung mas makapangyarihan, o binabaliwala ng mas makapangyarihan.
Okay, but then what does one do in this situation, just to balance the conversation, when the new president clearly has different policies from the previous one? I mean, let's be honest, when it comes to peace talks, you have some sectors that are actually happy that the president is now he's opened, right, the possibility of getting into peace again with communist rebels. And you have the vice president saying that's making a deal with the devil. So you have two extremes. That's one. Number two, with the West Philippine Sea issue, you have the president that's opened our relations to the United States, but the former president was also too extreme, pivoted extremely to China. So technically, you have two leaders that just, in terms of ideology and leadership, believe in different things.
Now, you can add a third one now, Karen. Itong People's Initiative.
Okay.
Again, by silence or seeming acquiescence, he is for it. And the former president is not. But at the end of the day, the time of President Duterte is over. But he's still a citizen, an influential citizen at that, who can influence a lot of people. But the one who carries the baton is the sitting and incumbent president, and that is President Marcos. Now, in a democracy, it's okay to disagree. As the saying goes, I will shout to the highest heavens that which you would oppose to the top of yours, but we should not go at each other and come to blows. Itong hindi pagkakaunawaan sa pagitan ng Kamara at ng Senado, hindi naman to darating sa puntong hindi ko ma-pronounce sa baragdulan or meaning coming to blows, no?
Baragdulan. go on.
Hindi naman to darating doon. That's why in coming out, even in your program or other programs I've been out, I have been calm and objective about it, and simply calling a spade, and proceeding with all legal means available to us, either as an individual or as a Senate.
Okay. Now, the level of discussion, and considering that it hasn't been half term yet for President Marcos Jr., it's roughly been 2 years, right? 2.5 years. Am I correct?
Yes.
Yeah, right. 2.5 years. Is you already have this kind of bardagulan, as you said, number one, the former president already calling him a drug addict. right? And then you have the president's son calling him lazy. In effect, I'm rewording it, lazy, unfeeling, lack of compassion, called him actually to resign. So it's gotten to this level of discourse. And it's not even campaign period yet. What are your thoughts on this? Because I don't think the president will go down to that particular level.
We saw this in our history, Karen, too. If you remember, former President Estrada's term ended in a little over 2 years.
Yeah.
The level of rhetoric early on in his administration, too, was far worse than this one. And it culminated with EDSA DOS. Again, we should look at history always to learn from it so that we won't repeat it, instead of being cursed to repeating the mistakes of the past over and over again. And that has been said too about President Marcos by the former president as well in his speech. Na sana, huwag mangyari sa kanya yung nangyari sa kanyang ama, at sana, yung kabaliktaranan, pagpulutan niya ng aral yung mga pinagdaanan ng kanyang ama para hindi niya napilit pang ulitin pa.
Okay. And then you are colleagues with Senator Aimee Marcos. So it's a bit confusing to the public seeing her actually supporting former President Duterte and the words uttered by the former president and the son against her own brother, who is now the president. You won't even see this in U.S. politics, that you have a family member on the other side. What is going on, Senator? I mean, you sit there in the hall, you see the behavior of your colleagues. So tell us, what is this? Is this real or is it for show?
I think it's real, Karen. To begin with, di ba nagagalit yung tao minsan pag magkakampi, magkakasundo yung isang pamilya at pinagkakaisahan tayong lahat? Sabi natin, uy, sindikato, conspiracy na yan. Mas gusto natin, di ba, minsan na may mga ibang pananaw na nagmumula sa isang pamilya para makita natin na kahit papano, hindi man sila gobyerno, pamilya man, ay may checks and balances. But to be fair to Senator Marcos, she has not directly hit the president yet, to my knowledge. For example, na nag-attend siya dun sa rally sa Bulacan, di ba pinanalangin niya na lubayan daw ng mga masasamang espiritu yung Pangulo. Di naman niya sinabing masama yung Pangulo, pero may mga masasamang espiritu raw sa palibot niya. He's not yet directly hitting the president. She's blaming, for example, this PI on the speaker, and not yet squarely on the president. But as I said, if the president continues to be silent on this, or simply allows it or lets it pass as if nothing is happening, then at some point the blame will be laid squarely in his office, in his person.
Okay. I think my last question on this is, you've had your share of historical knowledge, background, experience with different presidents. Your father at one point also served the late President Marcos Sr., right? And you had former President Duterte saying, kumbaga, I'm rephrasing it, he could end up like his father. If the president keeps pushing the people's initiative, is there a threat or danger that he won't be able to finish his term? Does that threat still exist today?
I do not know, Karen. Quite frankly, I do not see it, and I hope that will not happen. To be fair to former President Duterte, he also said that he does not wish this to happen to him as well. Nobody wants that, Karen, because nobody wins should that happen. Basically, what happened in 1986 was a coup d'etat, which was later supported by the people through EDSA People Power 1. So, baliktad. Yung tao yun ang protekta sa militar matapos gumalaw ng militar laban sa pamahalan. Nobody wants that. It is never in the interest of any country for that kind of instability to befall a country or its government or its people. And I hope, again, I hope that the president will see this, not because his position might be endangered, but because the country doesn't need this noise, this divisiveness, and this kind of rhetoric. We should all be focusing on what's important to the poorer segments of our society, instead of simply talking about our own respective welfares as to how to extend our term, remove term limits, only run. These are not helping our country and government right now.
All right. On that note, I want to thank you so much for joining me today. Thank you, sir. Senator Francis Cheese Escudero. And by the way, before I leave, congratulations to you and Hart. I know you have a renewal of vows. Very soon. Okay, but let's add that because we do. That's still part of, I mean, you have press people that may want to hear this. Why did you decide to do that? So you were married, was it February 14 or 15?
15.
You were married February 15. Would that be 10 years ago?
Yes.
Roughly 10 years ago, yes. Right?
And you don't celebrate the 9th.
You don't celebrate the 9th. Okay. So you were married 10 years ago. I was there at your wedding. And you have decided, both of you, to have a renewal of vows 10 years this coming February 15. Now you have some couples that do this on their 20th, on their 25th, you know, some might say 10 years, that's too soon. Why would Cheese and Hart do it 10 years?
Well, I have friends who do it not every, but on the 5th year.
Really?
I have friends too, who do it on the 7th year, okay. Especially given the 7-year itch, so to speak. So It really depends, because if you are truly in love with each other, you can actually do it every year if you want.
Well, 10
is a good number.
Uh-oh. But why did you choose this year?
Only because we have a lot of things to celebrate, which I guess we would be able to share, announce in the next couple of months to our friends. It's not really something that the public needs to know coming from us, but there's a lot to celebrate in life right now, in our family, in our marriage, between us, with her. Not so much with me, but that's good enough for me as well. My marriage, my family, and my home.
All right. Well, on that note, congratulations to you, Senator Escudero. You deserve all the happiness when it comes to your family. Thank you for joining me today. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen. Good morning to everyone.